Welcome to another concert at the Crane School of Music. We would like to remind you that the use of any recording device is not allowed without the prior permission of the performers. In the event of an emergency, please exit the building through the marked exits and move away from the building until instructed to return. We hope that you enjoy today's performance.
Welcome to the first full program of the Music of Gregoria Kraidasuki, a centennial celebration. I'm Jessica Suki Pilalis, on sabbatical to catalog the works of Gregoria Kraidasuki and also to celebrate the centenary of her birth by programming her music. The most popular, the unknown, anything I could find. Tonight's concert includes premieres, one premiere, but the music is in various styles throughout the three dedicated concerts in this series that you can see over there, and the concerts that have just one piece programmed in it, so six in total. By doing this cataloging and these performances as a sabbatical project, I'm not just being practical, every composer needs a catalog, nor am I just remembering my mother. Rather, I'm getting to know her better through score study and correspondence, but also through the performances that are part of the celebration. For several pieces in this concert series, no recording exists. Sometimes none was made, but more often, the reel-to-reel tapes are too damaged to play. Hearing these works played live, both in rehearsal and in performance, gives me invaluable insight. I want to thank each of the performers tonight, and also for the rest of this series, for being such an important part of this unique opportunity to understand my mother, the composer. So I have the program here because I know that you have to find it on your phones, and that doesn't always work. But with a quick look at that, I would like to welcome our first performance. Thank you. that Greek suite was filled with traditional melodies treated in a very untraditional way. To see where that comes from, what I'd like to do is give you just a little bit of background on the composer that might not necessarily be in the program notes. There. So, she's from immigrant parents, and this is a photo of her father. He came to Chicago as a busboy, with taking one room with a lot of other Greek men just to save money so they could send back money to the old country. But he moved to Milwaukee and bought into a photography business, which is why you may see lots of photos in the lobby, but why we have these, and you can see the size of that camera. So basically, he was able to bring his two brothers over, then wrote back and had a marriage arranged, so a wife came over, or a bride came over, I should say. And a year after that, in some months, my mother was born. So basically, there she is as a little girl, and next to her is the family. Music was a part of their life all the time. In addition to the photography business, they had this Greek band, and so right from the start, the children were they were studying musical instruments. So you see the mandolins on the left, and of course there's Gregoria, little Gregoria on the right. She loved to read music, and her father was actually also a distributor of Apollon Music. It was a publishing company in New York of things coming over from Greece. So she had all this access to music that she was reading. Basically, you know, they would send all this music to sell, but she'd read it. Like a book, she was an excellent reader. So the family also, George, the father, also had a Greek band. And this is the family part of the Greek band, but there were two men also that weren't family members, but good friends that were part of this band. So all these Greek melodies were just imbued. They were part of her musical existence. Of course, she also studied Chopin and Brahms and Mozart and Bach and everything else because she had a piano teacher. And basically, the Greek melodies were something that was intrinsic to the family. Eventually, she became the leader. Her father made her the leader of this band as it toured and did weddings and baptisms, but more importantly, Greek conventions. She did graduate from high school and then from college. Considering her grandmother was, you know, most of her relatives back in Greece were still illiterate, this was quite an amazing thing, and it had to do with some wonderful mentoring she had at the high school level in a good music program. So all of our Crane students, you know, going out to be music educators, this is what can happen. It was a good music educator that said, oh, you should study music. You should teach music. So this suite on Greek themes, basically, I was able to find some of the source material when I was back in Milwaukee doing research in what I didn't realize I had, but my grandfather's, her father's, gig book. So you can see how torn up that is. This was a very beloved gig book. I mean, things were just falling out of it. And but I was able to find the source melodies of many of the things that you just heard in the Greek suite. And they're all basically based on dances. With the exception of Save, O Lord, Thy People, which is a well-known melody chant in the Orthodox Church, and one that was is for the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross, which is September 14th, but one that was also sung on the walls of Constantinople when the barbarians were approaching as a hymn of salvation. And the text is, Save, O Lord, Thy People, and bless Thine inheritance. Grant victory to your people over the barbarians. They were at the gate. and by the power of your cross, preserve your commonwealth. And this is the same hymn, not the same melody, but the same hymn that Tchaikovsky uses in the 1812 overture, the Russian version of this hymn. So just to kind of show you, at one point my grandfather evidently copied out a hymn by hand that was part of this suite. So I have that there as well. So anyway, I'd like to go on to the next piece, which I always smile at because my colleagues who teach music theory should sympathize. When I'm teaching music theory, I'll say, what key should we be in today? And always some guy or gal will say, C. C. We've got to be in C. You know, not C again. Really? Well, evidently, my mother had the same problem as a music theory and composition teacher because basically she wrote, just for fun, I set myself the challenge of deliberately excluding C. I think she was so sick of that. So this is an 11-note scale that this next piece is written on. Sorry, I didn't advance that. Next C piece is written on, Soliloquy sans C. There is not a C in it. Ha. And so with that, enjoy a piece with no C.
So you know how long this piece is. 6 minutes.
So that piece was fully atonal, and my mother was a person that wrote in every possible style. It was something where she always felt she had to explore something new. At this point, though, we're going to return a little bit more to the extended tonality that we heard in A Suite in Greek Themes. And if I can get this back up. This is based on the folk song Mia Papadia Ston Argaleo, a priest's wife at the womb. Loom. Oh boy. So this is, first of all, a priest's wife back in the village usually didn't dance. Being at the loom was fine. But this song is about a priest's wife dancing, because she gets a little bored at the loom and takes a few sips of wine and goes down to the shore and, you know, just kind of dances away. When my mother sets this folk song, at the very end, I think you'll kind of hear the gossiping of the villagers. It has quickly changing meters, and part of the changing of the driving meter, a 7-8, 1-2-3-4-5-6-7, 1-2-3-4-5-6-7, which you heard in the Greek suite, this one gets a little interrupted. I think she's getting a little tipsy. So the rhythms are very hard to tackle in this particular piece, and my mother even kind of left a note about how from the first performance there was 12 years until, she had a lot of requests for scores. She sent them out, but there was actually 12 years between that and the next time it was actually performed. So the challenges in here are good with the polyrhythms and everything else. There's one other thing I learned looking at the scores, and that is that over where the composer's name should be in the score, that was often taped over with another name. That was common when you would submit for competitions, and a lot of her pieces won competitions. But for this piece, I found a number of different scores, and each had a different name. What I noticed is that every pseudonym was male. I think she knew that as a woman composer, it would be better not to reveal that in competition in those years. So anyway, with that, Bacchanalian Triophony. I'm going the wrong direction here. The next piece, A Fantasy for Piano, is also one of the more atonal works that she has written. But in this one, we feel more of the Greek rhythm in it, specifically that 7/8 that is so much a part of Greek circle dancing or line dancing. And it was a piece that she had performed a lot of times, and others had too. But it is actually quite a challenge to do it because, again, it's not melody that is holding this in a Greek sense. It is the rhythm. So with that, Fantasy for Piano.
Thank you.
technical difficulties here. Keeps throwing me out. I'm starting from the beginning just to get where I was. And evidently it's not going to allow me to do that. So I'm just going to talk from a memory and get rid of this thing, if I can. When all fails, turn it off. So we're now going into a part of this program that really was something my mother loved, and that was two piano music. In the house in which I grew up, there were two matched Steinway L's in the living room. She just loved duo piano works, and reading things and everything else. So she wrote a number of pieces in based on Greek themes, and that's how we will end the program tonight. The first one of those is The Amando. That's the title of the tune. And she had two names marked on the score. By the way, this will be a world premiere tonight. She never really sent it out for performance. So the other title for it is Argument, Mother and Daughter. And the song, The Amando, is about a mother who makes requests of her daughter, and the daughter always finds an excuse not to do them. And with each verse, there's an upping of the request, and of course, more stubbornness comes in. The first version that I found of this ends just where the song ends, but then there's a second version with an additional 10 measures. And in that 10 measures, it marks in the part, the piano, that is the daughter, parentheses, giving up, and her dynamics decrease, and the mother's increase. In other words, my mother wrote a victorious ending for the mother. I was about 6 at the time. And she described me at that point as obstreperous. So, nothing goes away, huh? So I can't prove this, but I think that there is a little something in this piece. Mom, you got the last word, I think. Now, the pieces after this, she also wrote that this piece could be paired with three lovers. There's a note written on one of the scores. Pair with three lovers or Greek Rhapsody. Now, she orchestrated The Amando, or Argument, three lovers, and she wrote Greek Rhapsody specifically for orchestra. So orchestrating all three of these, their orchestrated version, will be performed on November 14th, the actual date of her 100th birthday. But tonight you hear the original two piano versions of Argument and Three Lovers. So again, this is bitonality, extended tonality, with these Greek melodies as their basis. Thank you very much, and I thank again the performers. I hope you come to some of the other things where you will hear a very different style. On the November 14th concert, you'll also hear her Latin dances, which are very tonal. So she really has a lot of different music. In the series, we were not able to include her electronic music score because it was a ballet. It was the first electronic music score written at that university and probably in the state of Wisconsin. It was very experimental at that point. But we were not able to resurrect the dance, unfortunately. But But certainly in the next two concerts, you'll hear very different styles coming in. And then the last one, on the 19th, is her vocal music. And again, a very wide range of styles. So I hope that you will be able to come to those. But with that, I'd like our musicians to close with two pianos, two music for two pianos.